And
yeah,
I was a migration agent.
Yeah.
And I gained access.
So
as soon as I gained access and knew.
Okay, we might get started now if everyone wants to take a seat.
Because my studies were the ICC.
Okay, we're going to get started now if everybody wants to take a seat. Okay, welcome to the Refugee Action Collective Forum tonight. Firstly, we just want to acknowledge that we are meeting tonight on Aboriginal land, land that was never ceded, land of the Wurundjeri people of Kulin Nations. We pay our respects to them and to the elders past, present and future. Welcome to the Refugee Action Collective Forum. We're a voluntary group fighting for asylum seekers and refugee rights. We are fighting to close Manus, Nauru and Christmas Island detention centres. We meet every Monday in this building at 6:30 p.m. And everybody's welcome to attend these meetings. We have three speakers tonight. We've got Tracy Aylmer, who's come over from Western Australia. Is that right?
Yes, yeah. That's where you say it.
And Katie Robertson, and we've got Lach Marshall from RAC, and I'll introduce Tracy first because she's going to be our first speaker. So Tracy is an advocate and a former lawyer who filed a case with the International Criminal Court against the Australian government's refugee policies. And I'll throw over to Tracy now.
Thanks for having me. It's been a long trip, both from Perth and in relation to what I've done with the International Criminal Court. I want to talk about accountability of Australia with the International Criminal Court, and I'll keep calling it the ICC because even though it sounds like ISIS, it actually isn't. It's the other side of ISIS. To start off with accountability, I need first to talk to you about accountability throughout the ages. The first international criminal trial happened with a guy called Peter von Hagenbach. And I know, I really like saying the name. He decided that he was going to try to destroy a small city in an area that is close to the German-French border. He was finally captured. The trial took place and he was found guilty and then decapitated. That was in 1474. And yes, his defense was that he was following orders. So obviously that wasn't accepted. From then on, there was talk about an international criminal court that wasn't really agreed upon for quite a few centuries until later on in the 20th century. But before that happened, there was Nuremberg and the Holocaust. And I won't go into detail in relation to the Holocaust because everyone knows it. Nuremberg trials also showed the defence of following orders, and for those higher up, that wasn't accepted either. Then, after that, accountability happened with, let's see, Chile, Argentina, former Yugoslavia, South Africa when it comes to the sanctions, Rwanda and Sierra Leone. There's, when someone crosses the line, when people cross the line, there has been, with these circumstances, accountability. There is a line for war crimes and for crimes against humanity that are crossed, and when they are crossed, accountability happens. So getting back to the Permanent International Criminal Court of last resort, drafting the ICC Rome Statute has only been a recent concept because there was such disagreement for such a long period of time that agreement can only have occurred towards the end of last century. It happened. It was a great thing. And then 60 countries signed off on it, and Australia was one of those countries, thanks to Julie Bishop. So she actually has done a good thing for us. Only one good thing, though, unfortunately. So the ICC came into being from the 1st of July 2002. And when the Rome Statute was signed and agreed upon by Australia, Australia had written legislation for the International Criminal Court Act 2002, and then also changed the Criminal Code. So Chapter 8 details everything that's in the Rome Statute that are considered crimes. So it's genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and aspects of the crime of aggression. Not all of it, because they haven't agreed to all of it, but some of it they have. Since the ICC was formed, accountability has happened with a few more situations, but they've mainly been in Africa. Only recently have they happened outside of Africa, but the reason why Africa was targeted is because it was easy and because the previous prosecutor, Luis Moreno Ocampo, politicised the ICC. He decided that Western countries would remain unscathed. It's a part of what's called complementarity. So when it comes to something such as the justice systems of Western countries, because they are so strong, Luis Moreno Ocampo decided that they weren't going to be considered because domestic legislation could sort things out, according to Moreno Ocampo. Because of this, he didn't touch situations such as with John Howard, with the ICC submissions that have come about in relation to that. Now, I've checked out the evidence for John Howard's submissions, and there is no direct link between what John Howard did and the Iraq War, so that's not going to come about anytime soon unless we find information that can implicate John Howard to the Iraq War. And that's going to be pretty hard with Mark Pezzullo being in place, unfortunately. So now I'm going to talk about my submission. And the reason why my submission gained leverage is because I had access to the manuals and guidelines from the Immigration Department. It showed in the Detention Services Manual in several areas that the Minister is directly responsible for everything that happens in detention centres. So that is the crucial amount of information, of evidence, that the prosecutor would need to show the direct link between what happened in the detention centres and the minister. So both Scott Morrison and Peter Dutton are directly implicated in this. The prosecutor accepted my submission on the 16th of May 2014. The reason why she, the new prosecutor, who is Madame Fatou Bensouda, why she accepted it is because there was more than enough evidence there, including photos, the manuals and guidelines, witness statements, media reports. I showed quite a lot of detail. In September 2014, the prosecutor sent me a letter stating that she was putting the submission into archives because there wasn't enough jurisdiction. So the evidence was there, but the jurisdiction wasn't. Then Scott Morrison changed the legislation and allowed 157 Tamil asylum seekers to stay on a boat for 30 days. When the High Court accepted this, 2 days later I received a letter from the International Criminal Court stating they were analysing the situation because most of the facets had come up. Now, this is how difficult it is to get what could be classified as a Western country to the International Criminal Court. There are three ways that the prosecutor could investigate a situation. The first way is if the UN Security Council asks the prosecutor to open an investigation up. The second way is if the government asks the prosecutor to check the situation. And with that, the prosecutor goes to what's classified as a pretrial chamber and asks the pretrial chamber judges to allow her to open a case up. The third way is if the prosecutor has enough evidence on her own in order to check it, then go to the pretrial chamber and ask the pretrial chamber to open the investigation. The prosecutor has stated that she needs more than enough evidence in order to open the investigation. For Australia, it has been very, very difficult to find all of the information, all of the evidence to try to get to the standard that she requires. As an example, she opened an investigation for Kenya because of a situation during election time where people were murdered. That didn't go too well because, sorry, line of thought. She only had witness statements, and those witness statements, my line of thought is gone now. Those witness statements, there were witnesses who ended up at the International Criminal Court. Kenya was uncooperative. They eventually murdered two of the ICC witnesses and forcibly ensured that some of the witnesses changed their statements. So that situation ended up in a total and absolute mess, and that was only in March of this year that no one could be prosecuted for what happened in Kenya. That is the reason why we needed an infinitely more amount of evidence to go to the International Criminal Court. There will be accountability with Peter Dutton, with Scott Morrison, with several others, but we needed an enormous amount of evidence to get there. We then needed the public interest, and that included international as well as domestic public interest. The type of public interest where there's been a backlash, where there's been Australia becoming a pariah, where we're not listened to anymore, where our reputation is trashed. Those are the types of things where Peter Dutton has decided that we aren't going to accept the refugees into this country no matter what. Him and his attitude, his behaviour is something where the prosecutor would be looking at this and saying, no, that's unacceptable, that's crossed the line. All of this, absolutely everything that has happened, especially recently, the Nauru files, manuals and guidelines, video footage, photos, absolutely everything is going to ensure that there is a case for Peter Dutton, for Scott Morrison, for the others to be shown in the dock at The Hague. Thanks.
we've got Katie Robertson, who's a refugee rights lawyer and who led a case that successfully prevented over 100 babies being transferred to Nauru that were born to asylum seekers in Australia.
Thanks for having me. Nice to see everyone, a lot of familiar faces, and thanks to Peter and Chris and everyone else for asking me along again. You guys know how much I like ranting about this issue, so I always appreciate the opportunity. We just thought tonight, given that Tracy was talking more international, that I could give a bit of an update on what's going on the domestic scene, and sort of have a bit of a general update about Nauru and Manus in particular. So I actually think, I was thinking about this today, I think there's an announcement in the works pretty soon, and I don't know what that announcement will be, but I think there's one coming. And the reason I think there's one coming is for a few reasons. If you look at what's been going on in this space domestically, particularly in the last few days, maybe I'm a paranoid conspiracy theorist, but I think that there's some indications there, and I won't be surprised if we see Turnbull come out and say something in the next month or so. So firstly, I think many of you will have read that Wilson Security have decided they're not going to continue their contract. Now, Wilson Security, as you all know in this room, they've said, I think the quote is that they're no longer operating these offshore detention centres is no longer in line with its long-term strategic priorities. Now, I don't buy that for a second, because the amount of times and the amount of scandals that have come out in relation to them over the last few years is pretty intense. And so I think that's your first indication that they have got a smell of the wind, and they've realised that they might as well put some PR in place now to pull out before any sort of official announcement in relation particularly to Nauru. That, and I think the No Business and Abuse campaign's been incredibly effective, and we as consumers have been incredibly effective at hitting them where, which is the only place where they care, which is financially. I'm not sure if anyone read over the weekend, but our good friend Paris Aristotle also came out over the weekend. Do people in the room just generally know who Paris is? It's a pretty amazing name. So Paris Aristotle, I think nominally he's a psychologist.
Trauma specialist,
yes. So he holds a position with the Victorian Foundation for Survivors of Torture, but where I'm interested in him is he's been a senior advisor to both political parties in relation to refugees and particular offshore processing. Very senior, very very much in the ear of Scott Morrison, very much in the ear of Peter Dutton, has been a big supporter of offshore processing, and was pretty heavily involved in massaging the legislative changes that went through at the end of 2014. Do you guys remember when Scott Morrison introduced this raft of pretty dramatic and damaging changes to the Migration Act? So the reason I flag that as well is Paris Aristotle has not been one to outwardly criticise regional processing or the effect it's having on people for the past few years. So I think it's very interesting that he decided to do an exclusive interview with Fairfax on the weekend. Again, the cynic in me would argue that there's some PR there going on in his name, so that he, you know, when whatever happens, that he can claim that he was, you know, on the right side. Thirdly, the Obama summit. Has anyone heard about this? Yep. So the Obama summit's coming up in late September after the UN summit. The Obama summit is invite only, and it's pretty hard to score an invite, and they've been really clear that the only people that will be invited to the table are countries that are serious about upping their humanitarian intake and are serious about bringing some serious money to the table. Now, Turnbull was not invited up until a week ago. Now, I think that's really interesting. So Turnbull, Julie Bishop and Peter Dutton will now be attending that summit. So again, I don't know details, but I'm looking at all of these signs, and I think my money would be that there will be an announcement just prior to the Obama summit. What that announcement will be, I'm not sure, but I'm just flagging some of these signs to have a think about. And I guess briefly tonight, I wanted to start by mentioning those things to sort of frame what I'm going to say along the lines of, I think we're really close to getting some change in relation to Nauru and Manus, which is fantastic, but what I'm worried about is what's going to happen next. And I think that's what we've got to be alert to in the next stage of this movement. So just briefly, I thought I'd touch on Manus, Nauru and Australia. So everyone in this room will be familiar with the fact that in April, the Supreme Court of Papua New Guinea ruled that the Manus Island detention centre was illegal and must shut. Unfortunately, which is the flavour of these things and which is what I'll argue overall in relation to law in this space, it's inherently political. So you get this judgment and everybody sort of rejoiced and thought this was fantastic. And we saw, I think it was 10 days ago, that Dutton met with the Peter O'Neill, the Prime Minister of Papua New Guinea, and confirmed that the detention centre would shut, and everyone was really euphoric again. And I was bitter and cynical, and even though that's great, you know, when are we going to actually see some change and these words become action? We still haven't really seen that. The situation is unsustainable as it currently stands, where there is an open centre, and it is, I would also argue for you, argue to you that it's not sustainable for people to be resettled in Papua New Guinea. We've seen that with the people that have been successfully resettled. At least a couple of them have actively tried to break back into the detention centre, which gives you a bit of a feel for how they've found that resettlement process to be. So I think I'm preaching to the choir when I say to you that's not sustainable. And similarly with Nauru, some of you may have also read that there's a challenge on in the Supreme Court of Nauru in relation to sort of a similar argument in some respects, indefinite detention and you know, that impeding on people's right to liberty. I wouldn't be holding my breath about the success of that court. I think Nauru's proven itself to be much less independent on numerous fronts, and particularly the judiciary there. But the reason I flagged those two is I think it's clearly the writing's on the wall, and I think clearly the government sees it, they've seen it for some time. It's just a matter of diplomacy and politics in terms of how they're lining up their ducks to make an announcement, whatever that will be. And that's where I think the danger is. I think the danger is we are in such a bad situation, and that even in the public consciousness, with people that don't normally engage in these issues, most people, when you say Nauru, they sort of go, oh yeah, sexual assault of women, you know, abuse of children. I think that most people understand that Nauru in particular, but also Manus Island, are really bad places to be sending people, and that the logic of stopping the boats and, you know, preventing deaths at sea doesn't reconcile with the treatment people are undergoing. And my concern is that because things are so bad, any alternative that's going to be put up is going to be seen like a good option. And I think that is where we need to be careful as a movement and as activists in this space, that we don't allow any quick fix that's put forward to be seen as a viable option. I'm not sure what alternatives are looking likely. There is a rumour circulating that the Philippines is back on the table, particularly with their current leader, who doesn't care too much for human rights. So, I mean, that's something that's been, I've heard whispers about, but it's reasonably unclear at this stage. So, that's kind of what's happening in Nauru and Manus. But I also wanted to just touch base quickly about the hundreds and hundreds of people that are here at the moment that were part of the Let Them Stay cohort. And as many of you know, continue to operate in legal limbo. None of them have had the bar lifted, meaning none of them are eligible to apply for an Australian visa, and they're still liable legally for return to Nauru or Manus Island at any moment. Now, in practical and political terms, that's unlikely to happen, and we haven't seen any attempts to remove any one of the 300 or so people that are in that cohort. But I guess I'd just encourage you to think about at the micro level, what that actually means for people on a day-to-day basis. So they are living in community detention for the most part, but that means they're not able to work, and they're very restricted in their movement, and they don't have much control over their lives, and they have no certainty of what's coming. So I think at the domestic level, I would argue that's probably one of the most pressing issues. But again, I think, I suspect politically there's some plan in place for those people. I think hopefully it's pretty unlikely they'll be removed back, but we need to make sure we're fighting for their basic rights in Australia in the meantime. And then we have, of course, the legacy caseload. So all those other people that were successful in terms of the government saying, we'll let you apply for a temporary protection visa. That processing is going incredibly slowly still. I cannot for the life of me understand how it's possible to be so slow. But I think there are a number of issues that continue in that space. There's been a lot of suicides, particularly in Sydney recently, with certain people that are just feeling so bleak and depressed about the fact their claim hasn't been processed. If it is processed, the best they can hope for is a 3-year visa, etc. I do think there is some cause for optimism in that space, and that I think we will start to see this various state governments step up and actually say that they will declare large tracts of land, or indeed the entire state in some cases, I suspect, as CHEV zones. So if you guys are familiar, CHEVs are the 5-year visas that have a pathway to permanent protection, but the catch is that you have to go and live in a remote or regional community, which many people are happy to do, but there's also not many of those visas. So I think that you might see the states trying to circumnavigate the federal government, as we have seen all around Australia by conservative state governments, which is fantastic, but saying, well, all right, if that's how you want to play it, we'll say Victoria or South Australia or Western Australia are our entire CHEV zones, and try and get around it that way, which is really encouraging as well. So I'd just like to finish by saying I think there's been a lot of discussion in the last fortnight, particularly since the leak of the Nauru files, which, can I just say personally, I'm really pleased have gone public, because I used to read those files like that on a daily basis, and one of the worst things about them was you couldn't talk about them or talk about them in the media, which was really difficult. So I think that's a fantastic start. But I don't think the time for accountability is right now. I think now is the time for action. And I think I'm concerned as well that we're getting very caught up in sort of calling for Senate inquiries and royal commissions and various other mechanisms. And I think we've had the call by Labor for a Senate inquiry drives me bonkers, mainly because for those of you who don't know, I've been working for the Greens, and I'm not here in that capacity tonight, but there's been a Senate inquiry that was led by Sarah Hanson-Young for the past 3 years. How much more bloody evidence do we need until we actually start acting? And similarly with a Royal Commission, there's just not going to be the political will for it. But again, we have the evidence. The evidence is here. We need to act before we damage people any further. So I guess I'd probably finish by saying what I think I said to you guys last time. It's that, and it won't surprise you, that the law is not the answer here. And I think it's fantastic to be exploring avenues domestically, and I think it's fantastic to be exploring avenues internationally, but unless we see political will in this space, and I would argue that in relation to international law as well, which I think Tracy mentioned, unless we see political will, we are not going to get change, and I think we need to stop waiting for a magic bullet. But overall, I think we're in a reasonably good place, and we've just got to keep this push going and make sure that we continue the fight. So that's me. Thanks for having me.
And now we've got Locke from RAC.
Cool. Thanks, Tracy and Katie, for speaking to us. I'll be talking more about, I suppose, the implications of the legal challenges for the wider movement, the way forward for the grassroots campaign, and I suppose more specifically the need to escalate by spreading the protest movement into our trade unions and workplaces. And in other words, I'll argue, we need to reactivate the kind of workplace activism we saw during the Let Them Stay campaign, but on a much larger scale, if we want to close the camps and bring them here. In RAC, we obviously follow the various legal challenges very closely, because they can seriously weaken the government and its detention system. As we've seen with the PNG Supreme Court declaring Manus detention illegal. And that's why RAC has tried to help by crowdfunding for the Supreme Court challenge. But as Tracy and Katie have mentioned, having something declared illegal is one thing, but getting that decision carried through is another. Manus Detention Centre was declared illegal in April, but nothing has changed for the men stuck there. And you know, as Katie was also saying, there's no doubt that Manus has to close. And after the outrage of over the leaked Nauru files, the writing's on the wall for Nauru as well, where, you know, refugees have now entered their 170th day of protest. I think it's around that now. And, you know, we also know that every day the detention centres are kept open, men, women and children are being seriously and permanently damaged. So, you know, it is a matter of urgency that the campaign, you know, make sure that they're resettled in Australia as soon as possible. But I think in order to do this, we do need to, you know, recall what happened with the Let Them Stay campaign back in February, when the High Court gave the government the green light to send the 267 refugees back to Manus and Nauru. And, you know, basically people power stopped them from doing that. And I think the reason this was so significant was that it showed ultimately that a protest movement that harnesses the organised strength of, you know, people protesting on the streets, people taking action at work, you know, is actually more powerful than the law. And, you know, of course, what I'm thinking of is the action by the Lady Salento hospital staff when they refused to discharge baby Asha from detention because she was destined to be, you know, with her family destined to be returned to offshore detention on Nauru. And it was only after, you know, a really tense 10-day standoff that the government backed down and released Asha and her family and, you know, the rest of the 267 into community detention. And I think an important element, you know, in that struggle was, you know, the backing they received from the union movement. So the Queensland Council of Unions organised pickets outside the hospital, you know, inspecting every car that was leaving to make sure it wasn't taking any babies. And I suppose that act of defiance really sent ripples, you know, through different sections of the workforce. So you had teachers in over 100 schools, you know, staging selfies, declaring, you know, demanding education, not detention. And there are other groups of workers doing that as well. But, you know, now because more refugees are being brought from Manus and Nauru, so, you know, Katie was saying it's over 300 now, because the government knows the kind of response they'll get if they try to send them back, they haven't dared to actually, you know, send a single one of them back. And I think that is a sign of the ongoing significance of the movement back in that started back in February. But I think it's ironic that back in February we had to actually defy the law to stop the refugees being sent back, but now we need, you know, a similar campaign, but on a much larger scale, a much stronger campaign, I think. This time we need to make sure the government actually complies with the law in terms of the PNG Supreme Court ordering the closure of the Manus Detention Centre. So, you know, with an eye towards this, starting on the 12th of September, we're organising a week of workplace selfies demanding close the camps, bring them here. We just met up before this meeting to call around our list of unionists and other sympathisers to encourage that to go ahead. Hoping it'll be a rolling wave of selfies starting on the 12th to go for about a week. But it's already, you know, started kicking off with some groups of workers. So in Sydney last month, some RAC members from Sydney organised for a refugee to address a CFMEU, the Construction Union Conference, the New South Wales Delegates Conference, and as a result, they, you know, had a little selfie demanding, bring them here, close the camps, bring them here. And, you know, it's not like we expect selfies to, you know, bring down the detention regime alone. But I think it is an important first step towards starting, you know, the necessary discussions we need to have at work with colleagues. And I think it's also an accessible point for, you know, getting more people involved actively in the campaign. It's quite an easy thing to do, but I think it can lead on to more substantial workplace activism, like, you know, organising workplace contingents to protest, rallies at work, like we saw with the Royal Melbourne Royal Children's Hospital workers demanding, you know, protesting against the refugee children being sent back to detention because it was making them sick. And, you know, I suppose ultimately, because of the yeah, because of the tenacity of the government, we do need to escalate to the point where there is industrial action by workers, like we saw at Yeronga State High School. The teachers there went on strike to demand that their student Mojgan was taken out of detention and returned to their school where she belonged. I think that's what it will take. Now I think the task of the Let Them Stay campaign, to stop the government returning refugees to Nauru and Manus, I think it's actually a lot more simple than the challenge we face now, which is, to force the government to close the camps. Maybe that's easier than to bring them here, which they're pretty adamant that they're not going to do. But I suppose, there is reason for some optimism, I think, because the movement has also grown a lot since February. And I think there is a lot of potential to organise the kind of campaign that can achieve that. So just one sign of that momentum being on our side was the latest RAC protest. There were about 4,000 people. I think it's important to point out that the numbers attending a protest are never the whole story. I think an important sign of the support for the campaign was that people, a lot of people I talked to mentioned that people on the footpath were clapping as we walked past or even joined the rally as we were marching down Swanston Street. I think that does show the extent of passive support for the refugee campaign. And I think it also bodes well for the workplace actions, the selfies. We need to activate those people at work who are, sympathisers but may not yet be at the stage of coming to rallies, that kind of thing. And on the other hand, the government is very weak. After the release of the Nauru files, over 100 former Save the Children staff, again defied the Border Force Act, which threatens them with 2 years of jail. By publicly calling for the closure of Manus and Nauru. That's another sign where the government expects that they will provoke too much of a backlash if they dare to prosecute anybody under the Border Force Act. And on the other hand, there's also no, I really don't think there's any enthusiasm for the Liberal or Labor Party's support for offshore processing. During the elections, Turnbull and Dutton went viciously against refugees, blaming them for unemployment and welfare dependency, that kind of thing. But it did them no favours. They're hanging on by a majority of one seat, and they're not managing that particularly well.
I think it was simultaneously milking unemployment benefits while stealing your job.
Yeah. I think most people kind of saw the contradiction.
Schrodinger.
But just before the election in June, there was a poll by the Australia Institute that actually showed that 63% of people support, bringing the refugees on Manus and Nauru to Australia. So I think we are swimming with the tide. We just need to actually make sure that tide becomes a powerful torrent that can wash away the whole system. And finally, I think the fact that Wilson Security and Broad Spectrum have announced they won't be reapplying for the contracts after they expire, I think it further discredits, the offshore processing regime in the public mind, because they don't even see any future in these detention centres. And I think that does help us to make the arguments we need to amongst friends and colleagues at work to. Let's put this thing to an end. This is the final nail in the coffin. But I think with the government so much on the back foot, we should go on the defensive and demand not only that they close the camps and bring them here, but that we make sure that the entire deterrence regime is dismantled. And that means the government provides permanent, not temporary, protection visas. That importantly, the government stops turning back the boats and actually provides safe passage for people seeking asylum. But I'm keen to hear what other members of the audience have to say on that matter. So, yeah.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, great. So we'll open the floor for discussion. So, Therese, is it Therese?
Yes, thank you. I have a question, well, two actually. One is, I'd like an update on Mojgan, because I believe she's still in detention in spite of the campaign. And the other was, has anyone been prosecuted under the Court of Forced Act?
No. I'll quickly answer the second question. No. So I was doing a fair bit of advice to whistleblowers previously who were wanting illegal advice before they went public. And to date, no one has been. And credit to those people, brave, brave people. Like, we would not be where we were if it wasn't for the whistleblowers and their, you know, coming out and having the courage to do that. So. Yes, exactly.
Chris, next.
Yeah, I think it's, I mean, it says something about where we are in the campaign, that the government doesn't have the courage to use that legislation that they brought in, which was to, you know, terrify people from speaking out. In terms of Mojgan, yes, she is still in detention. Teachers at the school where she was whipped halfway across the country from her husband are still campaigning for the industrial action. And actually, we're lucky this Saturday coming up. One of them, and also one of the teachers from Nauru, is speaking to the teachers' refugee forum here at 3 o'clock. So we're hoping people come and hear a bit more about what's happening with Mojgan, which wasn't what I wanted to talk about. I think there were two things that Katie said which were spot on and very important. And the first is that it's time to act, and the second is to be wary of unnecessary compromises. So the first one, I think actually Bill Shorten came out now and said Manus should close, Nauru should close, it's gone on too long. I think that'd be the end of it. I think it'd be, you know, it'd be enough to do it. But instead they're calling for the Senate inquiry and everything else, and that's not going to push it. But I think it is the case that, you know, I think we perhaps haven't quite reached critical mass, but I think we have fought the Turnbull government to a standstill. They tried to use the refugee bashing, it didn't work with the election, it's not working for them politically in the way that it used to. The contradictions of Manus and Nauru, you know, their policy is coming apart at the seams. There's no third country resettlement. Manus will close. It's just a question of what is going to happen to those asylum seekers. And I think we have to insist that they're brought to Australia, that they're not sent to Malaysia or the Philippines, you know, anywhere else. So I think that is very important. The second point is about, given the strength that we are currently at, and, you know, when I got involved 5 years ago, there were rallies of 200, and we got to 20,000 on Palm Sunday. It's, you know, it's significant. I think it is that we want a permanent solution. And we saw the article recently from Robert Mann and Fred Brennan and others saying, actually, maybe we should sell the thing where we accept both turnbacks and all the horrors in order to try and persuade the government. But what persuades the government is people on the streets, people in the workplaces. It's not the arguments. And particularly if you look back what happened to the refugee movement in 2005, 2007, when Rudd was elected. Again, we won to a sort of standstill. Rudd was elected on a much softer policy. They did abolish offshore processing for a bit. We never won the argument that deterrence should be part of the policy. And there was parts of the movement that said, let's go quiet for Labor, let's give them a chance, let's hop off the streets. And once the movement took its foot off the accelerator, when boats started to arrive again, they panicked and we got it all back. And I think we have to finally break that deterrence. I've probably gone on long enough. Just one other thing that's significant coming up. Doctors in New South Wales are having a rally for refugees on the 5th of November. I think a significant thing that we are seeing occupation groups starting to take those sorts of actions.
Thanks, Chris. Peter, you're next.
I just wanted to ask, I would be saying, that the can't know the sort of politics accountability. Well, I don't agree with that. I think we should use every means to have this policy. And I think maybe I should provide a bit of information that refugiation related, following Tracy's example, can also submit a complaint to the International Criminal. And we didn't do it as lawyers necessarily. We had a good argument, I think. However, the idea was to show the court that civil society is absolutely appalled and upset and becoming more and more militant about the way in which this government and its members have been handling these issues. Now, I don't want to go on forever. I just want to make a point that it's important that all the legal challenges that we can muster should be very heavily publicized so that the public, particularly both internally in Australia, but also internationally, because I think it's important for us to say that the people who make these decisions and implement these policies, and we name them all in our submission, are accountable. And it's no small thing to have the members of the cabinet and the prime minister put before the International Criminal Court to answer for their action. And I think particularly, I think we should try and get this bit of information into the media as much as possible and into the international media as much as possible. So what I'm saying is that legal is political, and let's use it.
Thanks, Peter. There was Margaret next. Oh, you didn't? Was that you, Kerry? Oh, because there were people before you then. I thought you said Margaret had it. Oh, okay. Can I come back to you? Okay. There was the man with the hat and the glasses. Yeah, you had your hand up.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yep.
Just to pick up the point made by the last speaker. In terms of building the campaign and leading power, I think it is critical that all the different groups in the refugee space and advocacy movement support the campaign that GERA is launching on the 12th. And there are a million members of GERA. GERA is going to launch a big media campaign on the 12th. And it is a very important, if you like, organization that I think has got a very large reach in the Victorian community, well, and Australian community at large. And I think that in addition to all the points that were made in terms of campaigning in the workplace, with unions, at our schools, and in other places of where we can, if you like, raise some of these very important issues, I think we really need to work on a united front to get the message across wherever we can, so that we force the politicians to actually do a backflip and to accept that the verdict of the Australian population and the Australian people is that enough is enough. Not only that Madison and Nunnally need to be closed, but as a number of speakers have said, the victims of the current system need to be brought here, and that the rights of the people who are in limbo at the moment, that Katie has talked about, need to be enforced and strengthened. And some of the terrible legislation that was actually supported by both Labour and the Liberals needs to be repealed so that Australia is no longer seen as a pariah that it has become internationally, but that Australia will return to its commitment to human rights and its commitment to social justice and give it. Given that it was one of the countries that was involved in the initial Universal Declaration of Human Rights and in the drafting of the Refugee Convention with direct input from Doc Ev. So that's just the point that I'd like to make.
Thank you. Thanks. I've got you down, James, already. So Kieran was next.
Yeah, I guess the other thing I'd like to come to is really picked up a bit in the GERA stuff is to stop allowing this false dichotomy of the both the debt subsidy or detention. And that's just a false way. There are alternatives, and that's a conversation we need to have more of. There's the academic paper that is academic for refugees has released its paper just recently, being signed off by 1,500 academics. There'll be more policy statements coming out shortly, and there are alternatives that are legal under international law that don't involve boat turnbacks, that don't involve people drowning at sea, that give safe alternatives to people looking for asylum. And Australia can stop spending more than the UN is spending in looking after refugees in Syria or looking after refugees in our region. Stop wasting the appalling situation that engenders harm, creates, leads people to self-harm and worse, and spend less money to drive a better outcome that allows us to position ourselves as leaders in our region rather than a country that is dragging its feet and creating harm to people at an enormous cost in dollars, at an enormous cost to people, and at an enormous cost to our reputation. So when people say, oh, we don't have this by fence to see, don't accept out those premises. There are alternatives, they are available now, and we need to get the government talking about them.
I think that's true, and just to respond, I agree with you wholeheartedly, and that's a lot of what I've spent working on, trying to break down this dichotomy, because it is false, as you point out. And I think just to flag, I mean, often the example you used about Rudd, sure, he closed the camps, but he did nothing to provide an alternative pathway for people to get here, and that's partly why you saw the rise in boat arrivals. You know, many of you may know, but we're not taking anyone from Indonesia or Malaysia at all. So you can stop the boats, but if we're not actually taking anyone from the places where people have registered for refugee status, that's not a solution either. And I just want to say I agree with you wholeheartedly. We need to start to talk about what are the alternative options, because there's a lot of them and they're sound, and we need to grab them.
Thanks, Katie. Our carrier is next, then Chris.
I've got a question to Katie. Have you seen any signs of indicating the minister is aware of the ICC submission? Do you think it affects in any way in decision-making interactions?
Unfortunately, this government's made it really clear that they don't care about international law, and I think that's not rhetoric for the media. I think that's a genuine philosophy that this particular brand of the Liberal Party have, and I think it goes quite inherently to the core of their political values. So unfortunately, no, I don't think they're particularly worried about it. But on that point, just quickly, coming back to what Peter said, just to be clear, I mean, I'm not saying that I don't think we should be exploring these legal avenues. I think it's incredibly important, the work we're doing and the work Tracy's doing and the work we're doing in Australia to keep that momentum going, because the reality is we wouldn't have the Let Them Stay campaign without the High Court challenge, without M68. We need the law there to often form the basis of a springboard for these actions. I guess all I was saying there, Peter, was I think there's a danger in this space sometimes to go, a Royal Commission will fix it. And I think, that's kind of what I'm worried about, but over to you, Tracy.
The question is, Tracy, thank you for explaining about accountability. Is there any opportunity for perhaps the employees of Wilson's, Sports Spectrum, Transdeal, G4S, or Serco, any of those places, for the personnel there to be held accountable for their actions on this?
There may well be. And the reason why I'm saying that is because if you have a look at the Nuremberg trials back in the late 1940s, two people were found guilty, and they were past CEOs of organisations that had formed the concentration camps back in the Holocaust. So there is an opportunity for it, but we'll just have to see exactly how that opportunity arises.
I've got Chris Slee next.
So one issue which I've been involved in lately is that people in the community, asylum seekers in the community who have had their visa applications rejected are being taken back into detention. Now, This particularly applies to Tamils from Sri Lanka, but I think also to other people as well. Now, there's a group which has been set up, which doesn't have a name, which is taking up some of these issues. So one thing they're doing is so the Department of Foreign Affairs in Australia has a report on Sri Lanka which says that everything's okay, basically. But they do acknowledge some form of essentially everything's okay, so therefore they've had to send people back to Sri Lanka. So, so one thing we're going to do is prepare a counter report which challenges the DFAT's report on Sri Lanka. So, taking things like the continued occurrence of torture in Sri Lanka and stuff like that. So, and we're also just looking into possibilities of legal challenge to on the grounds that the Refugee Review Tribunal has not taken into account every aspect of the situation in Sri Lanka. So things like the fact that under the law it's illegal to advocate independence and independent Tamil homeland. Many Tamils have done that, and so any Tamil who has done that has committed a violation of the Sri Lankan law, and then politically victimised for their opinions. So, anyway, I'm not sure about the legality of that, but we need to be looked at by lawyers rather than by us. But anyway, we've got to sort of look into that. Anyway, just for previous information about what's going on. Another issue has been with the trial of Jasmine and Pilbara for trying to block a plane from leaving. She did a plane which was being used to take a Tamil asylum seeker from Melbourne to Darwin with the likelihood of event that then being sent on from there to Sri Lanka. So now that Jasmine was found guilty on doing that. The penalty is not yet decided. It will be decided in November, so still keep your eye on that.
Thanks, Chris. Mitch.
Just a few points. I think there's a couple of things, like Tracy mentioned about people just following orders or whatever, but I think like in the refugee campaign there's been some really inspiring examples of people doing precisely the opposite. I mean, like definitely the first one is like the leaks of the narrow files where these, there's a psychologist actually on the camp who like released the files, to my knowledge, is like risking like going to jail for 2 years because the government made it illegal to release any information about what was going on after these camps. So I think it's obviously horrendous. And I think the example of the ladies in the hospital or the long condition is also important because it's also like people doing the exact opposite thing. Like the idea that ordinary people and workers can search police cars trying to leave like a hospital or whatever, that's exactly the opposite of what we're doing in everyday life where you know the police are the ones like searching a car, like pulling you over, like doing all that sort of stuff. So I think that's important, the power that you know people actually have. And I think that links into the broader argument we made about bringing the refugee campaign into people's trade unions. I think that also relates to the idea of the political solutions or whatever to offshore detention. Because I think one of the main problems with the trade unions in this country is that they're totally wedded and nigh uncritical of what the Australian Labor Party does on the detention or whatever. I think, they've passed motions, like sort of people like the CFMEU and the NUA in the Council of Trade Unions. Not on the most radical thing, but supporting onshore detention and all that kind of stuff. They're rejecting vote turnbacks, but some of those delegates voted the exact opposite way at the Labor Party conference, basically responding to the argument that we need party unity to defeat the Liberals. But like, what's party unity when, like, you know, the Labor Party, you go behind the Labor Party uncritically, when they were the ones that opened up Madison Avenue in the first place, which I think is also important to recognise. I think, like, all the, like, I mean, like, my student union or whatever, the MSA, the Monash student union, like, they are, you know, ostensibly run by the Labour left, who stands up for refugees or whatever and wants to, you know, challenge offshore detention or that kind of stuff. But their opposition is totally uncritical because they never put any conditions on that support. They gave $50,000 last year from, you know, the union funds to the Australian Labor Party election campaign and spent all their energies over, you know, the 3 months leading to the election, door-knocking in marginal seats for the Labor Party who support offshore detention or whatever. So I think that's something we need to bring to our argument in the unions as well. Is firstly, like, yeah, all these members should support refugees or whatever, but also we should challenge the authority of, like, the union officials and the people who all support the Labor Party uncritically, who dominate in the union movement at the moment. So I think that's a challenge for us as well in that capacity.
Can I explain following orders? It's actually a defence made by those who have crossed the line in international law. So if you've got someone like, I can't remember his name, for former Yugoslavia, he ensured that a whole heap of atrocities occurred in former Yugoslavia. Sorry? No. He was a lower general type within the military. He ensured that there were a whole heap of atrocities that occurred in former Yugoslavia, and he used the defence afterwards when he was at trial to state that he was only following orders from higher up people. So it's not actually what Paul Stevenson has done, it's a line of defence that Peter Dutton could use. And Paul Stevenson called me 2 weeks ago to ask me how to send the Nauru files to the International Criminal Court, and I showed him how. So just thought I'd tell everyone that.
Thanks, Tracy. James and then Lucy.
Just a couple of things. Firstly, in terms of leading budget, I think it's important just in terms of the stuff Peter raised, just to differentiate the difference between legal challenges and parliamentary inquiries. I think parliamentary inquiries are targeted again. I think they are actually dead in the nail in terms of they're a huge distraction. They're basically the way half politicians say they deal with something without having an ethic. And then, you know, we can see this with the racist stuff that happened with John Dale. You know, it's been, you know, the Royal Commission didn't get them to tell us it was what Yankees. Like, it's been, you know, there was something like, you know, how many hundreds or something different recommendations is that? Pretty much none of them were implemented during the Northern Territory intervention. It was then the same shit over and over again. Actually, like, it's important not just to say that every time you well, look, actually, like, as far as politicians are concerned, the only thing we want to see is action, and we want to see concrete action, not more inquiries or discussions, because we do know there are solutions. And in that sense, I think it's a very important thing about that there are solutions, and that we don't. Into Canada. here, I think it was something like 26 that had been processed. And I was wondering in terms of how actually making that reality and why there could be that disconnect. And in terms of the reality, what the avenues once things are actually passed, is that actually like it's great and it's an enforceability around those that are actually real and that people are here.
Well, the first thing I'd say, I think, I mean, you can legislate timeframes, firstly, but I think on a broader level, the reason it's more than that, I think there's around 2,000 that have been processed, but which is absolutely disgraceful. But I think on a broader level, again, as I think I talked about, there's this announcement. You remember at the time Abbott came out and said, nope, we're not taking, great quote, we're not taking Syrians. I don't know who his advisor was with that quote. But, and then over the weekend, the next course of days, everybody was this outpouring of vigils and people out in the street saying, we want to welcome them here. And then on the Monday, they came out and announced 12,000. I think the problem, in a sense, is everybody goes, wow, that's amazing, look what we've done. And then everyone goes back to doing what they're doing. And nobody's monitoring what's actually going on. And I think we see this time and time again. We see this with the let them stay babies. Like, everybody goes, yeah, they can stay. Well, no, actually, they can't stay. And I think it's very easy to, you know, we only have a certain amount of energy and time that we can give to this issue. So I do think, in fairness, you know, you're often trying to deal with the most urgent aspect of this. But the problem is people don't pay attention to what's happening and, you know, government gets away with it.
Katie, did you want to say anything, Tracy? Or...
No.
Okay. Lucy is next, and then Margaret.
Thanks for the panel. I was thinking about what Kieran said, actually, about the alternative solutions. And we were at the Refugee Advocacy Network, the network meeting last night. We got up for explaining the Bring Refugee campaign and a lot of research that they've done that was kind of showing that people with the Let Them Stay campaign, it was like one stage of accepting, okay, let them stay, they're here, it's not a massive change in the status quo, it's, you know, when people go on them meeting, you know, staying. But bringing them here involves a bit more of a challenge about, okay, well, that's dismantling the offshore detention camp, so that immediately brings up a question about, what is the alternative? And I think it's right what Kieran and others have said about, like, we need to, like, really uncut the debts at sea stuff and say, you know, there is no reason on the planet to implement concentration camps as a solution to debts at sea. That's insane. But I think the other part of the alternative solutions, I think there's some of that stuff that we have to be a bit suspicious of, because I think it is, there's stuff in there about, are they terrorists? Do we need to do checks on them? Who are these people? Are we going to be swamped? Do we need like a storage solution for refugees offshore before we process them here? And that is, you know, that historically has been the alternative solution in Australia, and it has, in so many circumstances, led to the implementation of offshore detention as well. I think we need to say, yeah, there are alternatives to people dying at sea. That's using, you know, making sure that we can rescue people from Indonesia, it's flying people across, it's using the Navy boats instead of turning them back, it's rescuing people. But I think we also have to accept that people are going to get on boats. Like when the Sri Lankans came after the Civil War, they were coming from Sri Lanka, they weren't coming from Indonesia or Malaysia, they were coming from Sri Lanka, and they were people who get on boats, no matter what is happening in this mad world, people get on boats and try and get to Australia, and when that happens, we have to accept them, and they have to win anything for that. We have to make sure that people in Australia accept that these are not the devil, these are some seekers, it's okay, we don't need to set up concentration camps for this to happen. In that sense, there's no need for a solution. The solution is dismantled camps, that's it. Do you know what I mean? I think there's a little bit of breaking down too about the politics in that. And all the other things, about, you know, the costs of billions of dollars, we use that to resettle people, we make sure people have visas and education and housing and so on. That's not solutions, that's using that money for something really good.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think.
Thanks, Lucy. Margaret?
Well, even though the staff members do want the situation to occur, according to conversations I've had with them, it is the final say is up to the ICC prosecutor. So it's up to her. So I can't give an actual percentage without knowing what's exactly in her brain at this point in time. The chances are much higher now because of how much evidence there is and how much international and domestic public opinion there is against them, as well as the illegalities of PNG, the Nauru files, all of the evidence. Absolutely everything is there, stacked against these politicians and whoever else the ICC prosecutor may want to consider. But the percentage I can't give at this point in time until she comes out with a final decision.
Okay, and the other part is, I'm thinking maybe I've done that at the moment, who I absolutely loathe. Yeah, if things were to change, I don't know that this institution and such a minister would be tenable anymore. And I just don't like the fact that even if he was voted out, he would have had some future change in his mind and been given comfortably without absolutely no consequences against anything at all. So if they were to take court, and if things were to work out really well, what would the consequences be that they face? Is it a jail-type thing, or is it a monetary-type thing?
Both. They've actually, in the Rome Statute, there are both. Articles 77 and 78 in particular relate to imprisonment. Article 79 relates to compensation and how much they would be fined. It could be in The Hague, or it could be in any of the other member countries. That's part of the Rome Statute as well. It's up to the court, the judges, upon what they consider, where they consider the jail sentences would be. There is a prison near the Hague ICC permanent court. So I could explain Article 77 and 78. Article 77 unfortunately gives a time limit of 30 years unless the atrocities are so bad that it would entail a life sentence. Article 78 is a little bit strange in that the, and it's a possible PhD proposal for me, in that if there are a few charges, according to one of the earlier articles of Article 6, 7, 8. If there's quite a few charges, well then the judges consider a sentence for each charge, considers the highest sentence they've given for the charges, and then the convicted serves that term. So I'm wondering why, and that's part of one of the proposals that I could consider and see if that could actually be changed.
Thanks, Tracy. Thank you. So I think we've got time for two more people. We've got Therese, you had your hand up before. Oh, sorry, a bit of a cue. Peter, was, and then we'll go Peter and Chris, and then that's it, yeah.
The government. We have a session of the inquiries and referrals to organizations that have been set up to look into this and look into that, important to government and so on. Am I right in saying that one of the conditions of the peer review for the International Criminal Court is that the domestic processes have to be exhausted?
There are two methods. One of them is that the domestic processes are unable to consider investigating on their own or prosecuting. That's the one that you're talking about that is relied upon very heavily with the International Criminal Court with Africa, because they're unable to consider or investigate on their own more often than not. The other one is if they're unwilling to consider an investigation. So while there's all these processes that are going on domestically in Australia, nothing's happening, so therefore it can be shown that they're unwilling to do anything to actually investigate, which is why jurisdiction has taken place with the ICC here. Yeah. Yep. They're unwilling at this point in time.
Thanks, Tracy. Chris, you're the last question for now.
I think there's a certain amount of propaganda value in the ICC stuff, but I do think we're going to win in change for refugees is going to be domestically. Europe is going to win to get justice for refugees. When it comes to crime and stuff, I think it's worth saying about death at sea, it's not just that there are alternatives. I think the same people who are committing the crimes offshore have had policies which have led to death at sea. So So you saw, for instance, it sets the politics for slow rescue times when refugees don't matter. So 6358, the coroner's hearing about the refugees make distress calls for 2 days, 16 distress calls, the boats taken on water, they were ignored, they were dismissed as refugees, out of the people ground. There were some people on ABC, you got Perry in the news, but three sailors, including one Navy captain, who says they were ordered by Canberra not to rescue a boat on Anzac Day because of bad health, and people on that boat drowned. It's criminalising people smuggling, so the teenagers crew the boats, it's the burning of boats when they get here. All these policies only add up to that horror. One other thing that I caught, the Nauru case has actually been heard in Australia, because the High Court of Nauru is the High Court of Australia, which I think says everything about the relationship between two countries, according to the Constitution. And the last thing is about the get-up stuff. It's actually starting on the 10th. They're going to run ads on TV. There's a family on Mount Atlas which has been separated. There's other families that are on the roof. Twin brothers separated. Husband and wife separated. But I think that is going to be a good lead-up to the Bring Them Here photos that we're trying to get taken on control. So I really would encourage everybody in your workplace just to pick up a few signs and hand them up and get some photos and get a photo. When I did it in my school, we got fantastic response. People I didn't know were interested. It brought people out of the woodwork. It's good, good opportunity to then bring them to the next rally. I'd really encourage people to jump on board with that.
Thanks for everybody that came tonight. Like I said, we've got a meeting every Monday night in this building at 6:30. Everybody's welcome. And especially like to thank Katie and Tracy and Locke for speaking on the panel tonight. You're all welcome.